part of these companies, right? Because you over it in Puerto Rico.
In the metro area.
So you, how many of you, do you have Netflix accounts? You have Netflix accounts. How many of you have Amazon?
Of course, right?
So you heard of this company?
Sure.
Sure, right? So they make all these cool devices and stuff. So what is the difference between these companies and this company? You know, there's just one fundamental difference. It's software, right? So these companies started out just on the web. They don't have any brick and mortar. A bunch of guys got together in a garage and said, let's launch this great service. Started out as completely software. No hardware involved, right? You can access any of these services in any device that you want. And they started out after the internet revolution took place. In other words, nowadays, to launch an internet company is very easy. You don't have to go through all these laws and regulations and permits and all that to operate in a particular geographic area and all that. So it was easy, relatively easy for them to form these businesses than Apple, right? Apple was an old hardware company. So they started out. The slide that I forgot to put in was those old Mac.
I still have one in the back of the closet.
Have you seen those old clunky Apple IIs and all that kind of stuff? From there, they went to here. Unlike these companies, you know, that was easy. They just started there. But Apple would have easily said, oh, we have so much infrastructure already invested, we have legacy systems, so it's very, very hard to change the culture. Can't be done. Steve Jobs came and said, nope, we're going to reinvent the company. And so he reinvented the company, took out all the excuses, and launched the iPhone. So what is common between Apple and universities? We're mired in tradition. We're very much mired in tradition. We have so much legacy. We have so many baggages that carry with us that prevent us from almost doing anything because things are not being done that way. So let me segue and tell you a story. I was meeting with a faculty member 2 months ago in my office, and the faculty member asked me a question. So what do you guys do? So I said, well, we run hardware, software, we provide services, the network, to make sure systems are all running, and to make sure everything is working. So he says, and answer me the question again, what do you guys actually do? So I thought about it for a second and I said, we are trying to invent the next iPhone. Information Technology Services at CSUSB is trying to invent the next iPhone. So he says, you guys are working on a hardware device that's going to replace the iPhone? I said, no. iPhone is a concept. iPhone, while it's a hardware device, iPhone is really a concept. It changed the way you collaborated, you communicated, you played, and you did a lot of business. So at Information Technology Services at Cal State San Bernardino, we're trying to invent the next iPhone in that. We're trying to find the next model which will dramatically change the way students learn, the way faculty teach, and the way we achieve operational efficiencies across the institution.
I've got a very timely example from my institution. When we changed a couple of years ago to having students do their registration online, we were sending out email messages. Guess what? Half of our students got their registration erased because they didn't
inventing the next iPhone mean is that we reach the students where they are. We communicate to them the way they want to be communicated with, and we teach them how to learn in their terms and not our terms. So it's a lot of shifting. So faculty who have taught the same way for 20 years, how are they going to change? That's really the legacy that we have that we need to change. So as instructional designers, we have a great opportunity in our hands to gently introduce technologies that are easy to use for the faculty and provide them the support that they need to change the paradigm. That's, so the conversation that I'm having with the academic technologies team is that how can you make it so easy for the faculty to use? It actually reduces their workload, it works consistently and it's reliable, and if they have any problem 24/7, how can they get help to resolve their problem? So that's how slowly but surely, one faculty at a time, we're going to invent the new iPhone. Now, it's not only on the faculty side, it's the student side, it's the staff side. Every area we're covering, we're going and talking about. We're in the midst of a strategic plan now. IPS, now the university put a strategic plan into bed last June. And now we're doing IPS strategic plan that's going to be aligned with the university strategic plan. And really, we're going to invent the next iPhone. So, next couple of years when I come here, you will see the evolution of the iPhone at Cal State San Bernardino. Oh, am I doing the time? Okay. So I'm almost done. So these are some of the things that we're doing on the infrastructure side and all kinds of neat little things that we're doing to harden our infrastructure, to put roadways in place for us to invent the next iPhone. So these are all, mundane, day-to-day kinds of projects. A lot of innovation in those, but these are the projects that are going to help us continue to elevate the platform so that faculty and staff can start innovating. So that's really my presentation. That's how we create value for our students, faculty, and staff at Cal State San Bernardino. And I'm interested in hearing your stories. Or questions?
What kinds of workshops and training are you doing for faculty?
A whole variety of them. So one of the slides, we have what we call a teaching resources center. Do you all have that? So this collaboration with the Teaching Resources Center. Teaching Resources Center is a center that provides teaching resources to faculty, not necessarily technology-based. Pedagogical training, curriculum design, all that kind of stuff. So we collaborate very closely with the TRC, that's a faculty-led department, in providing all kinds of training for faculty, right from the time faculty intake takes place, recruitment takes place. The TRC actually provides the new faculty orientation. We start there, and from there on, we offer workshops, collaborate, lots of workshops, lots of one-on-one time, and then we also have faculty champions in every college. So we actually buy out faculty time and say to this faculty member, are you willing to be our champion? We're going to buy you out from one course. Faculty have to teach 3 courses, right? So even if you buy them out from one course, then they have that time to help fellow faculty do instructional design and online curriculum changes. So it only costs us $4,000 to buy out faculty for a quarter. That's crazy. So $4,000 a year, every department I have faculty champions. The money that used to go to a lot of other babysitting hardware and software, we're putting towards faculty development. And when faculty see that ITS is investing in them, they immediately, our credibility raises, right? That we're not building our own empire, we're here to serve them and the students, then that helps.
Getting to the students, right? Do you research, do you research?
very happy with the way technology works on campus. You know, when I came in 2013, I overheard two students talk to each other. They said, never going to take a test here on campus again because I was taking my test and Blackboard went down, or the network went down, right? Wireless network was so unreliable. They would rather take their exam at Starbucks or McDonald's where they have a better reliable connection. So all that we have improved. Now, that is a very, very good question, and we need to conduct research to see how this is actually impacting student success.
So you get this support from there?
Yeah. And the way we measure it is with digital literacy, right? Digital literacy is a big issue for a lot of students. And I'm doing all separate research on the topic of digital literacy. In the olden days, it's like if you can't read, write, then you need remedial education. A lot of students, even though they have smartphones and all the technology, they are not digitally literate. They are consumers of information, not creators of information. So if we are not